evening, everyone. I'm Kevin Ramack, General Director of Minnesota Opera. Welcome to Behind the Curtain. We are in a different venue than often this evening because we have such fun stuff to show you. It's just better if you see it in here. And we're also recording this evening's performance, and it'll be webcast on our website for people who can... Hello? A little feedback, sorry. For people to view later. So in light of that, if you could make sure your cell phones are turned off, that would be great. And then I have a few people to thank. These behind the curtains are presented by Pine River Capital Management. And if there are employees of Pine River Capital Management here, I acknowledge you and thanks for your support. The production of Magic Flute is made possible by the generosity of Wayne Zink. The performances of some of our guest artists are sponsored by some generous donors, including Bonnie and Bill Frell sponsoring Andrew Wachowski, Patty and Warren Kelly sponsoring Jennifer O'Loughlin, Sue and Jim Nelson sponsoring Layla Clare, and Donald Benson sponsoring Julian Baer. This target is also generously underwritten by Target and a grant from the National Endowment for the Arts. I think that's all the thank yous. My job is mostly thank yous, so I'll get that out of the way, and I'm happy to introduce the Minnesota Opera's head of music, Robert Ainsley, who will lead you through the wonderful world of the Magic Flute.
And a wonderful world it is indeed. I'm so glad you've chosen to join me on this evening. You've come from a journey from the wonderful springtime light outside into this dark, dingy rehearsal room, partly because of the enthusiasm of your sheer numbers, but also because this is a very unique production, and we want to give you a little behind-the-scenes glimpse of the makings and the workings of what you're about to see and all of the wonders it contains. But I'm going to take you on a different journey, and that's a journey from dark into light, which is one of the things that the Magic Flute represents. And what are we talking about here? Well, the Magic Flute is one of the most popular operas ever composed, and it's written by certainly my favorite composer of all time, and that would be Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Now, through plays and films like Peter Schaeffer's Amadeus, I'm sure you all know the basic sort of landmark keystones of this genius's life. But just a brief recap, he stands as one of the greatest prodigies in history. He was a prolific composer already by the age of five, a virtuoso on many instruments. Before he reached the age of 10, before he was even in double digits, he had performed and played before most of the major royal households of Europe. And it is his universalism and his eclecticism and the fact that he spans all possible and available genres that were being written in at the time that makes him so special. So he wrote in every possible genre and invented a few of his own beside that. But he didn't just light in them. He wrote masterpieces of such quality that they defined the peak of perfection in any style or genre he chose to write. He may have been equaled since, but he has not been surpassed. So his three last symphonies stand as three of the greatest symphonies ever composed. His string quintets, his string quartets, all of the very finest examples of the genre. His piano concertos are a peak of balance, of simplicity and virtuosity, of difficulty and transparency, and beauty and strife that has never been equaled. His piano concertos are simply perfect. But then there's his violin concertos and his clarinet concertos. He invented the piano duet, and I can go on, his church music, his unfinished requiem, his solemn vespers, the wonderful C minor mass. Anything he touched turned to gold. And sadly, he died at the age of 35, which is one of the great tragedies in all of art history. But he was a very special man. And I think to know where Zauberflöte is coming from, you need to know what's leading up to that. So, he leaves Salzburg, where he'd been the court composer, and he didn't like his boss. That was basically the reason he left. We've all done it in the past. And he moved to Vienna in the beginning of the 1780s, and his plan was to become a freelance composer and performer. And that's exactly what he did. And for the first half of that decade, he was incredibly successful. He was performing on a nightly basis as a composer and as a conductor, writing compositions, getting valuable compositions from many benefactors and patrons, making a huge name for himself. All of the doors of the aristocracy were open to him. He was the man about town, was Mozart. But something happens in the second half of that decade, at the end of the 1780s, and his fortunes take a distinct downward turn. He stops receiving commissions. He finds it harder and harder to get gigs as a pianist or a conductor. And his finances plummet. He finds it increasingly difficult to support his beloved wife, Constanze, and their two sons. He actually had six children, but four died in early infancy, which was not unusual in those times. And 1789, 1790 are deeply black years for poor Mozart. We see in his letters these obsequious, embarrassing, fawning letters to patrons and benefactors and his close friends begging for money. And for a man, he was confident, he bordered on arrogant, but if he had any degree of self-awareness, surely he knew that he was one of the greatest artistic geniuses ever to walk the face of the earth. And no one would pay him. No one would ask him to write music. It must have been incredibly hard on the poor man. So I think it's fair to say, I think it's clear from the signs that he plunges into a deep depression in those 2 years. And his work, his output shrinks to quite a low level for a man that prolific. But something happens in 1791, the final year of his life. And call it, I don't know, a presage of his imminent death. I mean, a lot of creative geniuses have this sudden flurry of activity just before they die. Maybe the activity actually tires them out and that actually causes the death. I don't know what it is. But it's not unusual. Or maybe it was just his fortune started to turn around. Some people blame the Austro-Turkish War of 1787 to 1791 for people forgetting about music and thinking about other things. But somehow he starts composing again. He finds his voice, and you can see him fight against these dark thoughts. He renews his faith in the power of music. He renews his faith in art and in fun. And you can see his love of family and children and all of these paternal issues that he's working through. It's all here in the Magic Flute. So where does the Magic Flute come from? Well, the Magic Flute was popular from its first performance. It was actually one of his most popular operas. It had 100 performances by November of the year after that it premiered, and he never lived to see that, of course. But it's represented difficulties for audiences ever since. It's still the fourth most performed opera in the world. But the difficulties come from its inherent ambivalence and its very sharp contrasts and contradictions. You know, it's a ridiculous plot. Paper thin, no one has any idea what's happening. Suddenly the goody is the baddie is the goody. Who are these people? Why is there a person dressed as a bird on stage? Magic bells? Pan pipe? What's going on, you know? It's difficult to understand. And the most common question that I'm asked, because everyone knows it's a masterpiece, is, what does it mean? You know, people mention things like Freemasonry, and occasionally they do even better, and the Enlightenment, and wonderful big words like that. But what does it mean? Well, I think the answer is everything and nothing. And it's a difficult question to answer, but it speaks through metaphor. The wonderful thing about Mozart at this point in his life is that he cannot set pen to paper without uttering something of the deepest profundity and humanity and perfection and love It's just effortless for him. He cannot do wrong. So no matter how thin the plot, no matter how stark the contradictions, the metaphors he's speaking in are great universal truths and represent states of emotion and being that have never been equaled. The Magic Flute truly is a miracle. It's a miraculous work, especially at this point in his life. So that last year is very special. It gives us the last piano concerto. It gives us the Requiem. It gives us the clarinet concerto. It gives us so many masterworks. It was a great year for Mozart, and he was on the up and up. He was fighting all of these bad thoughts. And the Magic Flute is really what pulled him out of the depression. So where did it come from? Well, it comes from an increasingly active collaboration with a theatrical troupe that was headed by a certain Emmanuel Schikaneder, whom you might well know wrote the libretto for the Magic Flute and also performed the first Papageno. And he was one of the great men of theatre, Schikaneder. A performer, a librettist, a composer, impresario, all of these things. And he'd helped build and found the Freihaus Theater an der Wieden, which you can still go to the site of, it doesn't exist, in Vienna. And this was a family theater. It's not the big sort of opera house downtown. This was more for the middle class and the lower class, this family theater. So this collaboration became stronger and stronger and resulted in this fantastical opera. And when Mozart wrote, he did what any good composer does. And that's he satisfied the needs of the audience, then he satisfied the needs of the performers that were to be involved, and finally, but not least, he satisfied his own needs as an artist and as a composer. He's a clever man, and he's a businessman, and these are good business tenets to have. So he's writing for a family theater, and there were expectations. It had to be a Singspiel, and not a through-composed opera. So we're looking at set musical pieces interspersed by spoken dialogue, not sung recitative. It wasn't just an opera buffa or an opera seria. It had to have both. Because if you paid money for a ticket, you wanted to laugh and you wanted to cry. But you didn't want to think too hard, but you didn't want to be stupefied. So it had to be frilly and light, and you could eat a meal while it was going on. It had to be fun for the kids. It had to have spectacle. We've got serpents, we've got flying spirit children, we have magic bells, magic flutes, we have trials by fire, trials by water, mysterious speakers in temples, pyramids, palm fronds, Masonic imagery, all of these things are happening. Because they had to have something to look at, this mysterious star-blazing queen of the night with this star-studded cloak. You can imagine these fantastic costumes that were being used. They had to have something to look at. They had to have something to hear. Fascinating instruments. An instrument called the strumento d'acciaio, the steel instrument, which we think is a sort of keyed glockenspiel. It's lost to history. That's the magic bells. So it needed spectacle. So all of those things are in there. But he had to satisfy the needs of the performers as well. So notably, not all the members of this troupe were trained singers. Papageno Schikaneder, he was an actor. He was a comic actor. Monostatos was an actor. Now, they could hold a tune, don't get me wrong, but they needed to get their pitch from the orchestra first, and they needed to be reminded of the melody they were going to sing. They also couldn't learn too much music, so they liked music that was in verses. So he's writing for those, but he's also writing for singers of great ability and great range. So Sarastro, the great and almighty priest, he descends frequently to a low F, which is about the lowest note written in opera on the stage. And that happens over and over again. You need a bass of great profundity to sing that. And of course, there's the Queen of the Night, who was played very much a family affair, who was played originally by Mozart's sister-in-law, Josefa Hofer. And she was clearly a singer of great ability. Fiery, fiercely difficult coloratura, and she frequently ascends to an F6, which you never see written. I mean, it's just as high as it gets in opera. So that's as high as the soprano goes. So he has virtuoso singers, and then he has comic actors, and he has to write for all of these. Now, this would have been difficult constraints to fulfill for an average composer, but not for Mozart. And the last person he has to satisfy is himself. So this piece acts as therapy for him. He's talking about his mother and his father. He's talking about, he was a Freemason, so he loved the Masons. He joined in 1785. Schikaneder was a Freemason. The person who inscribed the first school was a Freemason. And he was a member of the Illuminati, this sort of rational, clear-thinking, scientifically-minded people who headed the Enlightenment. And these principles of the Enlightenment he wanted to talk about. He wanted to talk about the journey from chaos and confusion into transparency and understanding and clarity. And he wanted to talk about dark things, about death and suicide and suicidal thoughts, and also about the love of family and kids that was so important to him. So there are all of these metaphors going on in the Magic Flute. And there are moments of such truth and profundity as well as childlike glee all of the way through. So let's sit at the piano and let's go just through a few of these fantastic references that you can find. And there's no better place to start than the overture, which is very famous. It's this great portal to this fantastical world, and three chords. Just those three chords, we've already got a bunch of symbolism going on here. So we're in E flat major. The number three was very special to the Masons, special to religion, you know, the Trinity. It's a sort of meant to be the perfect number. So three chords. Each chord is made up of three notes, no more, no less. Each one's a triad. Three chords, three notes each. And we're in E flat major, which has three flats. So 3-3-3. But this rhythm, you hear it later in the overture like this. Again, three chords, three times, just triads. But that rhythm would have been known to any Freemason as the rhythm you knocked when you were being initiated into the rites of the Freemasons. It's the initiation rhythm. So straight away, we're in the world of religion and Freemasonry. And then we have this. Much more romantic four-note harmonies and syncopations and surprise accents. That's very romantic. That's very Beethoven. More syncopations. Strange harmonies. And then much more chromaticism. Syncopated accents in a row. It's very Beethovenian, we would say. Beethovenian. And then we have this fantastic fugal allegro, so counterpoint at this point. It's a very Baroque thing to do. He stole the theme from Muzio Clementi. It's one of his piano sonatas. You sense all of those offbeat accents? Again, that's very romantic, very Beethoven. All of those offbeat accents, that agitation, Baroque things going on in the counterpoint, but romantic things going on in the chromatics and in these syncopated accents. So new techniques. He's trying to find a new mode for music. We have Tamino. Tamino is the prince. He's the protagonist of this opera. And he represents everything that's aristocratic and rational and cerebral and lofty about life. He's the good, the thinking, rational part of ourselves. And he sings elegant, princely, courtly music, but sometimes of great boyish charm. So his great aria, Dies Bildnis, starts with the same key, the same perfect key, and the same knocking rhythm that we heard, because he's a good Freemason. A Disabilitist ist bezaubern schön. But this awakening of new love is the most chaste and perfect and courtly example as you can. It's not some weird magical staring at a picture. It's falling in love for the very first time. It's a metaphor for that. Wie noch kein Auge je gesehen. More chromaticism. Ich fühle es. Naughty notes. Ich fühle es. Because he feels it so strangely. Wie dies Götter bild. More accents. Mein Herz mit neuer Regung. And what does his heart fill with? What new emotion? With this weird chord. Neue Regung fühlt. That's these strange, nauseating feelings this man is having when he's sensing this new love, this awakening of new love. So he's everything that's aristocratic and lofty and Masonic, and all he wants is knowledge. Then there's Papageno. Papageno is the birdman, and he's not a bird catcher. I mean, that's what his job is, that's what he gets paid for. But for us, he's a builder, or a car mechanic, or a waiter, or a pianist, you know? He's a working man, and he has simple needs and he has simple desires. He likes to go home, he likes his dinner on the table, he wants a lovely, pretty wife, and he wants to watch sports all day. That's what he does, yeah? And this is an untrained comic actor, and he's given folk music. And he's also given his pictures and his tune first before he sings, in case he's forgotten them. Beguilingly simple, but this wonderful little tune with its magic bells. Perfectly describes this happy-go-lucky character. And it fulfills entirely one of Sir Thomas Beecham's prerequisites for great music, and that is that it should enter the ear with great ease, but leave it with much difficulty. It's a whistleable tune. It gets under your skin. Der Vogelfänger bin ich, ja, stets lustig, heiser, hops, that's eyes, in a good mood. Ich Vogelfänger bin bekannt, bei alt und jung im ganzen Land. It's so happy, it's so childishly wondrous. And that's Papageno. And that's, I think it's the part Mozart most related to. There was a lot of Mozart in this. You know, he was bawdy humor, scatological, lots of toilet humor in his letters. So there we have two parts of ourselves. The cerebral, the aristocratic, the lofty. And then this simpler, basic needs, a lovely wife, a nice house, a job that you enjoy, that you do well. Even if it's a simple job, like catching birds. And the Queen of the Night pays him. She pays him sweet figs and wine and bread, and he loves it. It's great. Now, there are women, and the ultimate goal for these two men, through this process of going through confusion, and for Papageno, it's error, and for Tamino, it's trial and error. By the process of trial and error, they will achieve enlightenment, and they will receive a woman. They will receive their perfect counterpart. So for Tamino, that is clearly Pamina, and for Papageno, that is Papagena. And they both find these wonderful, wonderful creations at the end. And Mozart's women are some of his most three-dimensional characters. So everyone raves on about how sexist this opera is. And Freemasonry was sexist. No women allowed back then, you know? Silly. Women are irrational and unthinking, whereas we are the voice of rationale and wisdom. It's a very antiquated sort of thing, but Mozart's poking fun at it, because Pamina is by far the most truthful and the wisest and the most deeply feeling character on this stage. The women are always ahead of the men, and they are always much more clearly and beautifully drawn in Mozart's operas. The women always win. So the character of Pamina experiences depths of tragedy and emotional distress that we don't hear anywhere else in the opera, terribly deep. And I think these have to relate to some of the things that Mozart was feeling. So she talks about at the end of her wonderful aria.
Ach, ich fühl's, es ist Fleischwunde.
Now that's not about the fact that Tamino has taken a vow of silence. That's about not communicating in a relationship. It's about what happens to love when you don't talk properly and how tragic it can be. And there are, I think, something like 46 references to death in this score. So at the end, so wir treu im Tode sein, so wir treu, Tode is death, im Tode sein. He's almost obsessed. Im Tode sein, im Tode sein. And was there ever more tortured grammatics? It's as deep as music ever goes, that. And it's extraordinarily forward-looking. It's revolutionary. All of these cross rhythms, syncopations, these chromatic notes, and they get worse. So the kids notice her in her suicide scene. So we have that incredible descending sequence. Almost makes me sick to listen to it, you know? It's a nauseating sort of harmonies there. And it gets even worse. So when she's about to commit suicide, syncopations, ja, des Jammers Maß ist voll, falsche Jüngling, lebe wohl, sie Pamina stirbt durch dich, dieses Eisen töte mich. And of course she's saved in the key of the opera. She's saved in E-flat major. But this sequence, that's Beethoven plus, you know? That's practically Wagner. It's incredibly torn, tortured music. It's voluptuous music. And it would have been incredibly new to the audiences of the time. We always think of, you know, Mozart as being, I don't know, a goody two-shoes when it came to being revolutionary. But this is very forward-thinking. Now, when they get together, when Pamino and Papageno get together, his simplicity and her chromaticism, her sort of kinky twists of melodies, we have our Pamino over here, sort of combine, and we get something that is practically jazz, filled with all of these sort of offbeat syncopations and these weird chromatics, but with these bluesy, simple rhythms. So, schnelle Füße, rasche Mut, schützt vor Feindes, List und Wut, fänden wir Tamino noch sonst, erwischen sie uns noch. And sometimes, fänden wir Tamino noch sonst. It's nearly bluesy, it's nearly jazzy that he's getting at there. Incredibly forward-looking. And sometimes they turn to the audience and deliver a message, a metaphor right in your face. You can't miss it. It's often sotto voce. It's like Mozart is whispering to you. And this one was so special to Furtwängler, the conductor, that he took it almost half speed. And it says, if every brave man could find such little bells, his enemies would disappear without effort and he would live with them in the best harmony. It's not talking about magic bells. It's talking about the power of music, and it's talking about Mozart himself. If he could find new, wonderful music, then everyone would live in joy and brotherhood and harmony. And he says, könnte jeder brave Mann solche Glöckchen finden, seine Feinde würden dann ohne Mühe schwinden. Ja, da, 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 ja, da, da. The simplest but the most beautiful, heavenly, sublime music you can imagine. So there we have our basic protagonists. We have Tamino, we have Pamina, we have Papageno, Papagena, the lofty and the simple, and their counterparts. We need two more characters, and they are the most discussed. And the first is the great wise king, Sarastro. And at first we think he's the baddie, but he's not. He's the goodie. And actually Bernard Shaw, George Bernard Shaw, raved about the voice of Sarastro. And his first aria, I'm sure you all know. It's in three because it's very religious. It's like he's reading from the Old Testament.
Oh, easy son, dozy.
George Bernard Shaw said that if ever the voice of God was heard on earth, this aria was it. This was meant to be the one. But it's Masonic music. It's not classical music, it's ceremonial, more solemn. So classical music is represented by the galant style, which is a simple ornamental melody with very basic chords underneath it. Not planing chords like this, and not chromatic chords like this. So this is already
stärkt mit Geduld in Gefahr.
Very unusual music for a very unusual character. It's all of this ancient Egyptian symbolism. And Sarastro is the voice of reason and of wisdom and the scientific thinking method. He's the voice of the Enlightenment. In fact, you can go so far as to say he is an example of enlightened absolutism. Big words. Yeah, and that guy is a benevolent despot, someone who rules over, but by taking what the public tell him and by applying rationale and scientific thought. One of the most important cultural revolutions to happen, the Enlightenment. Nothing to do with superstition and myth and tradition and fear, but through light and clarity and rational thought. So that's Sarastro, the voice of good. And you'll hear, you know, more Masonic music, the march at the beginning of the first act. Again, very chordal, not just using 1-4-5, using lots of chords. And suspensions, very Masonic. Do you know this is actually what the Canadian National Anthem is based on?
Oh, Canada, oh, land of whatever it is.
I don't even know the words to the American National Anthem, never mind the Canadian National Anthem. But yes, it's dia, da, 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 dia, is the Canadian National Anthem. This is actually where we think he got the idea from it. So this is Masonic music. And this is obviously because Mozart was a Freemason, but we're talking about the Enlightenment and the journey of Tamino through confusion and chaos to light. And then there's the Queen of the Night, the ultimate mother figure. And if anyone's arias remind us of Beethoven, it's got to be this woman. And we've talked about these surprise accents and this chromaticism. It doesn't get any worse than this.
Der Hölle Rache kocht in meinem Herzen. Tod und Verzweiflung, Tod und Verzweiflung flammet um mich her.
And then listen to those chromatics. If I could play the piano, you know, extraordinary chords. It's wildly romantic, imaginative music. It's Mozart pushing the boundaries as far as they will go. It's the ultimate rage aria. But the Queen was meant to represent the opposite of absolutism. She was meant to represent, possibly, the Empress Maria Theresa, who couldn't stand the Freemasons and was known for obscurantism, which is hiding knowledge and hiding the truth from the public. She was known as the opposite of that. So she's a parody of that. And perhaps she's also the ultimate nagging mother. Was performed by his sister-in-law. Maybe they're talking about his mother-in-law. Nag, 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 nag. So it's mother and father figures as well that were going on. And there's so much more. I mean, the two armored men, we have these great pillars. Talking about myth and tradition, you know.
clearly we're in a scary place. Another pillar, the other man. And then a full fugue, a totally Baroque form, could be written by Bach. The counter subject is based on the counter subject in the overture, syncopated, now in the top. Fully worked out fugue, of course chromatic, because it's full of confusion, it's a trial. And then over the top of this wonderful fugue comes two voices in unison, singing a Lutheran chorale, a real one. Ach Gott vom Himmel sieh da rein. O God, look down from above. Dir welcher wandert diese Straße voll Beschwerde. It's a very academic piece of music. It's very Baroque. It's harking back to those old worldly, mysterious traditions that we have to shoo away. And he does shoo them away. And at the end of the opera, we have almost hyper-classicism, music of total transparency, total clarity, total simplicity. And this is the epitome of what we call the gallant style, the epitome of classicism. So in Papageno's second aria, just 1 and 5 chords, just dominant and tonic. A simple melody with ornaments, so it gets more ornamented the more verses. Full of ornaments. And never has music been more transparent and more clear than the final trials that Tamino goes through. And he beats those trials of fire and water with his magic flute, by the power of music, the power of art, and by the power of the Enlightenment. And here we have the ultimate simple ornamented melody with the most basic of accompaniments. Like glass, you can see straight through the music. It's like the gods at play. There's everything in this opera, absolutely everything. It's just a hint of all of the contradictions and all of the symbolism and all of the messages and beauty that happen. So let's have a bit of a snippet from two of our singers. We have our Papageno, Jesse Blumberg, here, and one of our young artists, Becky Quincy. If you just give me 1 second. They're going to perform one of the most joyful and childlike duets in the literature. It lasts about 2 minutes. And it's the Papageno-Papagena duet. Again, it's in this style gallant. Basically, only 2 chords in the entire piece. 2, 1, and 5. And it represents, through that simplicity, an entire love affair in miniature. Unbelievable joy and disbelief when you first meet your lover for the first time. Here, pa, pa, pa. And she answers, pa, 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 because she's in charge, of course. And it builds, and finally they sing together in what can almost be big musical hugs. Unsere liebe Kinder schenken, unsere liebe Kinder schenken. And they talk about having children together, and they practically go down the aisle together. Or maybe it's consummation, I don't know, it's one of those things. Kinderlein. Kinderlein, so liebe kleine Kinderlein, so liebe. You can see them in the church, you know, with the bells. And then they have their first argument over whether it's going to be a boy or a girl. Papageno, 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 Papagena, Papageno, Papagena. And then finally they talk about the joy of growing old and having your kids look after you in turn. So in two minutes with 2 chords, he produces music of the greatest joy you can feel and an entire love affair in miniature at a time in his life that was impossibly hard and difficult. And that's the beauty of Mozart's spirit. That's the power of his music. So, Jesse, Becky, if you'll join us, let's have a little bit of Papageno, Papagena. You have to imagine them covered in feathers. It doesn't matter which angle you look at Magic Flute from, it is one of the great musical miracles. It's a work of eclecticism, that's an essay in eclecticism that's never been equaled. It's full of tragedy and comedy, of profundity and absolute lightness and childlike joy, all of the way through. And we have a very special production. So we're going to take a little break, we're going to reset the piano, and then Tobias Rabinski, our wonderful director over here, and some of our singers are going to show you how this production works. So thank you very much, and we'll take about 10 minutes. So welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I have with me Tobias Rabinski, who is our director for this production, and who worked on the original production at Komische Oper in Berlin, and also the remount in LA Opera, both of which received rave reviews. And this is a particularly unique production, and I wanted Tobias to speak to you and demonstrate a little bit about what makes it so special. So please, Tobias, thank you.
Yeah, hi. So we heard now a lot about why the Magic Flute or the Zauberflöte is so special. And if you want to do this production, you always ask yourself, so what to do with this piece? It's so difficult. It's so full of contrast. And the idea was now for this production to celebrate these contrasts of comic and serious, of fairy tale and philosophy. And so Barry Kosky asked a theater group from London, 1927, to join him on this production. And they they put the magic flute in a world of animation movie. And so the idea is to use the animation movie and the actors live on stage and connect them. And so we are able to have an endless number of set designs and to make, to do really a magic journey in this fairy tale world. So in 1 second, we can go to the stars. In the other second, we're diving under the sea. And also, it's possible just to concentrate with a spotlight that is really keeping everything dark around, concentrate on just one character to get a very intimate moment that are always very important also for this magic flute. Think of the great musical moment Tamino Mine and Pamina Mine at the end, close to the end of the opera. So this all also is very good for the magic flute, the use of pictures as a concept, because you know the magic flute is an opera about pictures. As we heard, Tamino is getting the idea by a picture. He's getting the picture of the second lady, Pamina, and he's singing "Dies Bildnis ist bezaubernd schön." He falls in love to a picture and he searches for this. And also Pamina is more or less searching for a picture, and it's the picture of love. And search for love also, of course, is that what is Papageno struggling with, the search for the perfect vibe. And if he, Weibchen, huh? And if he finds this Weibchen or this little woman, that is a question we not really can answer. There we have to wait some years and see if he really found her or not. But so that is why it is so good to use animation and pictures for this opera, because you can handle all these contrasts, you can have the fun, but you also can find the serious and touching moments that are so, so important in Mozart operas. Connected with all this is the style of action. The style of action is connected to the silent movie of the early 20th century. That means also the characters that are presented on stage are based on characters of the silent movie era. So we have Pamina is more or less based on the actress Louise Brooks. She appears in Pandora's Box, a very famous film of that time, or still a famous film. And Monostatos is based on Nosferatu, so one of the great horror movies of that time, 1922, and still very, very actual. And up to date, I would say. And so Papageno is based on Buster Keaton, for example, because Papageno is not just a happy man. He's also quite a sad clown, because he's really struggling through all this work he has to do, because he has to follow Tamino everywhere he goes, because, and why? Just because he did a little lie about a big spider he killed. Well, that's nothing. That's very human, I guess. So this means we have the silent movie really has a big influence on this production. And that also solved the question what to do with the speaking text. As the magic flute is a Singspiel, you have acting scenes in between with spoken text. But as you know, in a movie, in a silent movie, you don't need this because you can't do this. And so we have text plates projected, and the text is really concentrated on the important things that have to be told in the story to get on, and these text plates, we'll give you an example later. So we have really somehow a silent movie with music, and you can enjoy the silent movie and the homage on the silent movie. You can enjoy the fairy tale. You can enjoy the search for love. It's possible to enjoy this show however you like. And just to tell you, everything is possible in this show. When we direct this yeah, we are now rehearsing in our third week, and it's quite a struggle to get into this, because you can imagine we have a big screen, and yeah, you can imagine if you're close to that screen, you don't really see what you're acting with. But it's so important to get the connection in the action to make this movie come alive, because a movie that's run through and a singer who's not knowing what's going on around him, that doesn't bring us a world of magic and the magic flute. And so I want to present you an example and to show you how difficult it is to get this action connected of the movie connected with the singers, with the action on stage. And I need a volunteer for the first example, because we are missing a tamino. And so we need one of you. You don't need to sing. It's also possible that a woman joins me just for a moment on stage. Who would like to?
You have to be quite energetic.
Yeah.
A little bit.
But just the arms, not the legs. So yeah, so come on stage, please. Yay.
Brava.
So, it also shows you how this happens. And so first, this is a screen. You won't see the screen when we project on it in several minutes, but please go behind it. And what you do, so I put you in the screen. This is the first scene of Tamino. And all what you have to do is doing this very fast and look like a big dragon is behind you, but you won't see the dragon, but we will, okay? We give you a sign, but we have to switch off the light for that, otherwise we can't go in projection.
I'll go from the end of the overture, Andrew.
Yeah, but we need first light off, and then we have to see. And as soon as you hear the music, you begin to do, but be careful that you don't hit your hands. So just do this.
Okay.
Yeah, and please, yeah. Just a second. And now, panic.
Zu Hilfe, sonst bin ich verloren. Zu Hilfe, sonst bin ich verloren. Der listigen Schlange zum Opfer der Koren, barmherzige Götter. Schon naht sie sich, ach rettet mich. Ach, rettet, rettet, schützet mich. Ach, schützet, schützet, rettet, 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 schützet.
That's it. Thank you. Okay. Yeah.
Lights.
Yeah, and imagine the Tamino has also to sing. What we heard from the piano, we won't hear like playback. He sings it live on stage. But he has to do this. And yeah, so you saw what's the problem. And you didn't see anything, I guess, of the picture, huh? Yeah, that's
Brava, thank you.
But thank you very much. So you see, that is one of the problems. You are, as the actor on stage, you don't see what you are acting with the most time. So you have really to know everything. And to know every little detail, what's happening behind, around you. Otherwise, we don't believe it, of course. And we have a second example, and to show how difficult it is also to act with the projection. Now you more or less acted for the projection or in the projection, but to act with it and to follow the projection, because the projection does its way, but you have to follow it in a way, that is even more difficult. So we show you one of the most difficult parts in the opera that is connected with Monostatos. But before we see Monostatos is doing this, we want to show it with a volunteer. Would you like to? Yeah. So take this glove and put it on your right hand, just because the wall is a bit scratchy. Yeah. And now So, light off, please. Come on stage. I am Tobias. Are you? What's your name?
Evan.
Evan, okay. So you see, you hold the dog like this, and now you have the dog and at the leash, yeah? Okay, and when I say go, then the dog will run away and you try to follow him, okay? Without letting him go, yeah?
Okay.
Okay, wait for it, so, ready? Okay, and go. Yeah. So, thank you. Right, very good, thank you. So you see, it's not so easy to get this connected. But now you know why we rehearse and why we're not just going on stage and doing the show. So now we want to show you the scene with an actor who hopefully doesn't know, right? to show you also the connection with a text plate following, so that you have an idea of what we are talking about if we talk about text plates that are projected on the screen.
So this is John Lindsay, one of our resident artists, who is playing the role of Monostatos. Thank you.
Yeah, so we have Monostatos, and we have, again, Papageno. And at the end, you also know who is based on Nosferatu and who is based on Buster Keaton, I guess. So let's see.
Okay.
Yeah.
Lights. Okay.
Wo bin ich wohl? Wo mag ich sein? Aha, da find ich Leute. Gefragt, ich geh hinein. Schwäbchen jung und rein, viel weißer noch als kleine.
Das ist der Teufelsicherlich. Das ist der Teufelsicherlich.
Hab
Mitleid,
verschon mich,
verschon mich.
This is just a small example of what we are rehearsing, what we are struggling with at the moment. And I think you also know who missed in this picture today. It's, of course, Pamina, tortured by Monostatos until Papageno, gets her and they try to escape. So that's so far everything from me.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tobias. Did you all grab a stool, would you mind? So, as usual, we're going to finish this with a little sort of round table discussion. I have Jesse Bloomberg here, our Papageno, John Lindsay, our Monostatos, and Tobias, whom you've just met, our director. And thank you very much for being here and for singing and for joining us. Let me ask you some questions and see how we're doing. So the production is terribly specific. It's, as you can see, it's a lot of the movement involved is sort of to the inch in terms of what you're doing. So how much of sort of, Jesse, how much of a constraint is that on what you're doing as an actor? And actually, how liberating is it to know just precisely what you're going to have to do? Are you finding it, is that this process, this rehearsal process, considerably different or from what you're used to?
Entirely different.
Yeah.
And I think it's both constraint and liberation at the same time.
It's a beautiful challenge, actually, to be in such an experience that it's more similar to entering the production for the first time. It seems more similar to choreography than to acting, where you'd come to it with your own choices and your own thoughts about the character. But the liberating part is that those choices have been made for you in advance. You know what kind of character you're playing, what kind of movements he makes, where he has to be at all times, where he has to look, and things like that. But it really is homage to the silent film style in the way we move, and the way Tobias is instructing us to move, and being true to the original production. So I think you'll all agree that it works, and you see that it works when you're in the audience. You don't always feel entirely aware that it's working when you're on stage, but you have to trust that Tobias knows how it works, and he knows that when he tells you to turn your head to the left, that it's because there's something amazing happening to the left that you can't exactly see, but the audience is going to get a real kick out of it.
I've noticed that there's an awful lot of trust involved, such as you frequently tell them you can't look at the projections, because as soon as you do that, your face is away from the audience. But if you do that, it makes the whole set look three-dimensional. But you have to totally trust that it looks realistic and that you're looking in the right direction. There's an awful lot of trust. So from your point of view, Tobias, it's such a specific production that you know extremely well. How do you make concessions for these actors to be individuals? What sort of flexibility is there for the performers?
I think, of course, it's always flexibility, because every actor is a human being on stage, and we are not having projections that fit into projections. So that means, of course, they have to learn everything what they do on stage, every look, but how they find their style, how they get into the character, because there is, of course, much character work as well, although it's a bit more limited perhaps in the first view, but you have to find yourself in the show. And I think that is still a thing you work on, and where I look what I think what would be the right way to get into this style that we need for this show, or especially there are moments that are very very good to work at, like normal, like you always do in the opera. Think of Pamina's aria. There is not happening so much that she always, like has to lead a dog on his leash while she is singing her aria. So there's always much, of course, much to work at. And I think it's also just, you just believe it if you see the human being, so the singer himself on stage, and not a singer who just reproducts or reinvents a choreography we have on stage. I think it's the same if you do a dance theater piece. Still, you have the dancer himself on stage and not just somebody who does the choreography. And I think that is, so it's, in a way, it's a normal kind of work in this direction, I think.
There are three of us that are sharing our roles, that are double cast. So I have great fortune to be double cast with Andrew Wilkowski, who's probably known to all of you, and he's terrific. And just to watch him do it, we watch each other a bit in rehearsals. And not only do I get to see how Papageno fits into the film, but I get to see his take on it, his interpretation, and how he's finding himself within limitations or constraints or whatever they are. But and vice versa. Just today, I saw him solve a problem, or it wasn't a problem for him, or vice versa, or who knows whether things are problems or solutions. It's just we're finding our own ways with it. But I saw him fix something for me that he was probably just doing naturally. That he probably was never a problem for him, but I thought, oh, that's how I can fix that.
Yeah.
So it's not exactly stealing from my counterpart. I think it's just, I think we're going to borrow tricks from each other.
So at not all points is the animation hugely active. So at moments of great musical profundity, for example, Pamina's aria, she's in a snow globe when she's singing Ach, ich fühl's. So that continues quietly in the background. But there are an awful lot of fast shifts as well when the action is fast. And one very important man in the production are these two gentlemen over here. And they're running the projections from a score that Andrew has in front of him that has, 600 to 700 musical cues. And each of those animations can run in real time for a certain amount of time, and then sort of loops before it goes to the next one. So the timing is very specific to the music and has to be called very carefully by these two gentlemen who are in control of it. So it speeds up and slows down in accordance with the sort of musical needs. So there is room for sort of individual play. So we have you mentioning here that this is a character; these are character roles, and we have two of. I mentioned that some of these roles were designed for comic actors rather than singers. Now we have very fine singers here who are actually quite used to singing lyrical roles, Jesse and John. And I know you've probably done Papageno a lot, and you've done other character roles in your time, but they're quite used to singing lyrical roles. So although these are designed not to be musically or vocally the most challenging, that is certainly not to say that they're not challenging roles to perform. They might have sort of limited vocal ranges, but there are certainly many other challenges that come with them. So John and Jesse as well, will you tell us a little bit about the sort of challenges of character work, and specifically Monostatos?
Sure. Monostatos was first played by a man named Josef Nusel, and he was almost 50 years old, and he was a pretty prolific actor at the time, and he was actually good friends with Schikaneder. He managed his own theater before he was employed by Schikaneder, but he couldn't sing at all, so it was a perfect part for me. And so the range is fairly low for a tenor the majority of the time, and it's also a lot of fast text, a lot of patter, so you have to enunciate very clearly, and it calls for Nusel was known for being overactive on stage. He was very declamatory and he was very overactive. So it's obnoxious, which is also perfect for me. And so it does require, you know, the note that I get after every rehearsal is, good, crazier, be crazier. And it's true, and you can always go further with a character role like that, because you don't have the opportunity to be as expressive with the music laid out in front of you. You have to kind of invent something. You have to make something to really pull the audience in and make them care about why you're on stage for these 2 minutes looking creepy and pulling people off stage. So I'm relieved I have an understudy now, so.
Was quite good.
He was very good.
It also helps that John used to be a gymnast a long time ago, so his physical capabilities are very good. You know, he works he picks up choreography very quickly, which is very important for a character actor. Character work is very specific work, and requires, they're not just sort of singers who didn't do very well. It really isn't that way. The greatest character singers are very fine singers. They often need a lot of voice, for example. But their ability with text and their ability physically has to be of a very high standard. It's a real niche role. And I think John's doing a particularly wonderful job. Now, Papageno is really, he's really just one of my favorite dudes. I adore Papageno. I think he's just a wonderful guy. You must have done a few of them. I don't know.
You've done a couple.
What do you like about them?
What's interesting about the way our Buster Keaton version here is that he's not the overly active and bumbling yet endearing idiot that he usually is. We usually love how over the top he is and how like overwhelmingly happy and it's this kind of like, aw shucks, I wish I could find a girl. In this, he's legitimately sad part of the time, and I think that does give us more opportunity. It gives us more contrast when he does get happy, when he does find her at the end, whether he will be happy several years down the line, as you suggest, we don't know. But you certainly get to see, he goes pretty far on the emotional spectrum. He sees a chicken and gets really excited because, you know, this is like the first time someone's cooked a real, you know, rotisserie. You'll see, it's a beautiful machine that they have making this. I think that, and there's something about the role itself, the vocal demands not being so difficult, almost gives you more, makes you feel more responsibility to do everything else, 200%. The comic timing, the relationship, the communication, and in this production, all of your relationship with the scenery that's going on around you. So, I think Papageno is a great role to play in any production, and I think it's particularly challenging and particularly rewarding in this one.
Yeah, I think if Mozart, I always think he related more to Papageno than he did to Tamino. I mean, he was obviously a part of him that was Tamino, but it's, you read his letters and all of that sort of
dirty toilet humor and wordplay that he was known for. And yeah, you just see more of Papageno within him. And I think, you know, Papageno has a true suicide scene that is deeply moving, where he calls out for someone to respond to him, and no one comes back. Alles stille, everything is quiet, the whole world is quiet. And when he calls out three times at the end, it's beautiful in the projections, I find it heartbreaking, you know, because it's basically Mozart calling out at that point. But he's rescued. And that's the wonderful thing, is that Mozart can represent the depths of despair, but with a half smile on his face at the same time. You know, it's that wonderful sort of balance that he was capable of. So I can rub it on to be, it's about Mozart being my favorite person in the whole world. You know, Einstein said about Mozart that he couldn't conceive of a being that intelligent. Couldn't even imagine one. He was quite a special guy, was Mozart. And you go on immediately after this to do a Marriage of Figaro back in Berlin.
Yeah, it's a revival.
You've done a lot of Mozart. So
yeah, a lot of Zauberflöte.
what do you love about Mozart?
So
both for all of you.
Yeah. So you already said something about this. What I love about Mozart is that you have human beings on stage. So you have this characters he wrote, and you have so much to discover why directing Mozart. And it's never white or black. It's always humans who's struggling with love and who want to get along in their life. And so, especially in Figaro, it's very, very obvious. It's a comical story, but it's so full of tragic as well. And seeing Papageno, I never thought of him as just a funny character. He's really suffering. And just because he's optimistic, that doesn't mean that he has no heart for the tragic side of life. And I think Mozart's music is also, he really manages to show with, yeah, not too much music, but really with the perfect amount of music to get deeply in our emotion and in our self, and to discover ourselves in the opera. And that's what it makes so special. Also, you can talk about hours with singers about Così fan tutte and what they think to find in Così fan tutte, and to go a different way or this way, and why do they do this, and why is she suffering, and why does she not just let herself go and love this different man. There are so many possibilities, and thinking that this is music that is quite old, but still you find the questions we are struggling ourselves with all the time. That is what Mozart makes so special for me, and why I like to work on Mozart operas as well, because it's and it's also for the singers. It's a bit a big challenge to present Mozart operas and to act in Mozart operas and to sing it. It seems to be, if it's perfect, Mozart music always seems to be quite easy in a way.
Effortless.
Yeah, but it is hard work, and that is what is so special about this composer and his work. Yeah.
So Mozart, along with Haydn, represents the epitome of what we call the classical period in music. And the problem with opera is that we love the romantic stuff, which is all about extremes. You know, people killing themselves and killing each other and falling in love. And that's what we love about opera, these extreme situations. And they tell us wonderful things about ourselves. But the classical style is about, it's like looking at the Parthenon. You know, it's about balance and poise and elegance. And there are great extremes in Mozart, but they're always tempered. So there can be depths of despair and the heights of joy, far greater than other composers ever achieved. But they're real, they're human, and they're balanced, like we are. You know, we're full of conflicting contradictions. And that's the effortlessness of Mozart, is this sheer perfection at all times.
In this opera specifically, I think you talked a lot about this earlier, you just have, there's really something for everyone. Let's say you don't like romantic music, you're going to love this opera. Let's say you love Baroque music, there's plenty, the fugue both in the, and later in the trial scene, and And Pamina's aria, it could be from a Bach Passion, with the exception of a couple of the chromatic things at the end, overly chromatic. But I think, let's say you think of all the times you've walked away from an opera and thought, oh, that was too silly, or that was too serious. No one's ever going to do that with this opera because it's got both. It's so much balance musically, so much balance emotionally, and musicologically too. If that's not your thing, then there's something else in this piece for you.
So it's the ultimate universal opera. It really is. If we could have another round of applause for our wonderful singers and our director. Thank you so much for being with me.